Okay, so we're celebrating our second 2 years today. Can't believe the 2 years have gone so quick, if you think about it. It doesn't feel like that long ago that we started this church, but time just goes so quick, doesn't it? Truly, life is but a vapor that appeareth for a little time and vanisheth away. I thought I'd say some interesting numbers from our church. You know, we haven't had the most exciting anniversary events. Sorry, because I suppose they take a lot of organization, don't they? But I think they've been memorable. Even if you think from the last church anniversary, there was a visitor that we had that sort of made that day quite memorable. And yesterday was memorable because of the rain. And who knows what will happen today that makes today memorable. But we started the church on the 1st of March 2015 at 16 Augusta Street, and that's actually just around the corner in Punchbowl. When we moved here, I was happy that we were able to move into a hall in Punchbowl, because then we wouldn't have to change the church name. We could stay as the church in Punchbowl. But you want to know, we started on the 1st of March, we had 22 people there. That was our very first meeting, and the amount of people we have there. Do you know what the lowest attendance we've ever had is? The lowest attendance we've ever had, thank God, it's not just been my family, you know, but it was the lowest we've had was 10. And that was on the 27th of November, 2016. No, sorry, 15th of March, 2015. So I think that was the third Sunday. So 2 Sundays later, we had the lowest attendance ever, and that was 10. And if you remember who was there on that day, it was my family. It was only 5 at the time because Abel wasn't born yet. And I think Sarah was in the womb. Then Edna was there. It was Michael, Ricky, and then Gershon and Christine. That was the 10 that were there on that lowest Sunday. So lowest attendance, the highest attendance. Do you guys know what our record's been so far? 61. Yeah, 61. So that didn't happen too long ago, actually. That was a Sunday where the stars aligned and all the inconsistent people happened to come on that day. And it was like, just shot our record through. I think before that it was like 51, and then that day it was like 61. So I don't know where, is anyone, somebody count the heads today. I don't know, there's a lot of people here today, so maybe we'll break the record or get close. And that was on the 27th of November, 2016. So that wasn't actually too long ago. And now, looking at the numbers this year, we're hovering at about 40 to 50. So thank God, you know, we're growing. Like I always say, you know, we've got to get that soul-winning number up. We're growing in church attendance, and we've got to get that soul-winning number up so more people need to get involved. And that's really what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about teamwork. Teamwork, and I thought that would be a good topic to talk about as we think about us as a church, because you know, on the anniversary, generally you reflect on what we've done in the past year as a church and looking forward on what we will do. So I want to talk about teamwork and just a few thoughts there, and hoping I don't plan on preaching a long sermon today, but we'll see how we go. So let's read Nehemiah 3, because there are many passages like in this in the Bible. And we'll read this, and we'll read another passage as well, where seemingly a lot of names are given. And you read through these passages, and these passages are sometimes, you know, you get that feeling like when you're reading through the genealogies, right? And when you're first reading, when you first have a read over of the Bible, you're not really sure why these passages are here. And obviously, they are very important for certain things. But one thing I always get from these passages is you get an idea of how many people are actually involved in a great work for God. You know, and whilst great works may be led by one person, generally the work, this great work is not accomplished by one person. Like one person may be raised up to lead the charge, but unless it's like some miraculous event, right? Like we're not talking about miracles where God did something great, right? And just used one man. We're talking about when it comes to our physical work, where we actually put in the effort to serve God, not God doing the work through us. It's usually many people that make those things happen. And Nehemiah 3 is one of these examples. I'll read it to you. Then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brethren, the prophets. So if you remember the story of Nehemiah is them going back and rebuilding the wall. And they builded the sheep gate. They sanctified it and set up the doors of it. Even unto the tower of Mia, they sanctified it. Unto the tower of Hananiel. And next unto him, builded the men of Jericho. So you see these people are working together side by side, aren't they? And we sort of get this picture of, you know, as a church, we are trying to build a building, aren't we? We're trying to build a spiritual house. And we need to work side by side as we build this spiritual house. And next to them builded Zaccur, the son of Imri. And the fish gate did the sons of Hasenaiah build, who also laid the beams thereof and set up the doors thereof, the locks thereof, and the bars thereof. So we can see that there's a lot of different things happening here, a lot of different components, and different people bring different things to the table to get this one common goal accomplished. And next unto them repaired Meremoth, the son of Urijah, the son of Koz, and next unto them repaired Meshulam, the son of Berechiah, the son of Meshezabeel. And next unto them repaired Zadok, the son of Baana. And next unto them the Tekoites repaired. But their nobles put not their necks to the work of their Lord. Isn't that funny that, it's usually the higher ups that they're too good to get in the trenches. Isn't that funny? Sometimes it's like that in churches, right? Where it's all the members that are going soul winning. But then, so I've been in churches in Mexico where like the bishop will show up and then he goes and does something else, as opposed to like actually going soul winning with the people as well and actually being involved in that ministry. Moreover, the old gate repaired Jehoiada, the son of Paseah, and Meshulam, the son of Besedeiah. They laid the beams thereof and set up the doors thereof and the locks thereof and the bars thereof. And next unto them repaired Melatiah the Gibeonite and Jadon the Meronothite, the men of Gibeon and of Mizparan, and unto the throne of the governor unto this side the river. I won't read the whole chapter, but you sort of see the picture just for the sake of time. But you read through and you read name after name after name after name, and you kind of think, why are all these people getting mentioned? And I think there's two reasons why they're getting mentioned, among other reasons. One is to show the teamwork, to show that there are so many people involved to make this happen. It wasn't just, because we think it's Nehemiah, it's Nehemiah's wall. You know, Nehemiah and Ezra built the wall. But we don't realize, no way, there was a lot of people working with them to make this thing happen. And it's not only in the Old Testament. I'll show you a passage here in Romans 16, where again, I have heard this passage preached where people think, well, Paul is ending this letter in Romans, and he just lists off a bunch of these random people, and it's just like this random hall of fame that nobody knows why. But I think the reason why this chapter is in the Word of God, one of the reasons anyway, is to recognize and show the churches in the New Testament, hey, the reason why the Roman church was doing so well is because look how many people were involved to make it happen. Romans 16, I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church which is at Cenchrea, that ye receive her in the Lord as becometh saints, and that ye assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you, for she hath been a succorer. So to succor is to support, my understanding is, a succorer of many and of myself also. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. So Priscilla and Aquila were husband and wife. But isn't it interesting that, you know, when often in churches when people are single, they're serving the Lord, and then they get married, and then all of a sudden they're too busy to serve the Lord. But is that what a marriage should be like? No, a marriage should be like Priscilla and Aquila's, where your marriage actually makes you serve the Lord even more. You know, and they were recognized here as being a husband and wife that served the Lord. Who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. So not only being recognized by the church leadership, but recognized amongst the church. You know, we talk about men pleasers, you know, not with eye surface as men pleasers. You know, is it just me that you're trying to get to see that you're a really hard worker? Or is it everyone in church? If you would ask anyone in church, they're like, wow, that guy is a hard worker and does a lot for this church. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Salute my well-beloved Epaphroditus, who is the first fruits of Achaia unto Christ. So we see there a new believer, right? He's a first fruit, but yet he is recognized as somebody that is doing a great work for God. Because you don't have to be, you know, you don't have to be saved for a long time, you know, to do a great work for God, because you get saved, you can grow straight away, get involved, just like Epaphroditus is here. Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us. So it's even people serving those that are trying to minister to the Lord. Salute Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners. So you see that these people were even in the hardships with Paul, when Paul maybe it wasn't a church event, he was going out, and then they got persecuted together. Who are note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. I'll tell you just an interesting thing there, who are known among the apostles who also were in Christ before me. So remember, we talked about new believers, but we also see old believers here, not just in age, but they were there even before Paul was, right? But they're still serving the Lord. Not the more mature people where they're like, oh, in those days when I served the Lord. Yeah, but back then, no, you can be serving the Lord now here and be note amongst, it says here, the apostles and the church leadership. Greet Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. Salute Urbane, our helper in Christ, and Stachius, my beloved. See, look at all these names. Salute Apelles, approved in Christ. Salute them which are of Aristobulus' household. Salute Herodian, my kinsman. Greet them that be of the household of Narcissus, which are in the Lord. Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord. Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Salute Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Patrobus, Hermes, and the brethren which are with them. Salute Philologus and Julia, Nereus and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints which are with them. Salute one another with an holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you. So we see here the list of those in the Roman church. But look here, as we're going a bit further down, because this is going on to another topic. When Paul starts to give his salutation, verse 21. So we see not only here is there a lot of people working together, pulling their weight, doing their part in the Roman church, but look how many people are accompanying Paul as Paul is writing, or as he is dictating this letter. Timotheus, my workfellow, and Lucius, and Jason, and Sosipater, my kinsmen, salute you. So you see, we think about Paul's journey and all the great things Paul did, but was Paul alone? No, right? Yeah, maybe Paul was known as the leader. He was the leader that was spearing the charge. But if it was only Paul, do you think he would have done as many great works as he did had people not been involved and made things happen? Look at this. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, salute you in the Lord. So Paul didn't even write all his letters, do you know? Because, I mean, Paul was an older gentleman. The epistle to the Galatian church, we knew that he had written a letter with his own hand because it was such an important topic, this topic of, you know, work salvation creeping into the church. But, you know, there were epistles here that he didn't write. He didn't write all his epistles. He had people helping him. Gaius, mine host, so people serving him and taking care of him, and of the whole church saluteth you. Erastus, the chamberlain of the city, saluteth you, and Quartus, a brother. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith, to God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. Now that didn't really have anything to do with the topic, but those last salutations always sound so cool, don't they? You know, the way Paul ends those letters and how he gives praise to God. So this is what I want us to think about as we go into the next year is, you know, what can you do better? You know, what can you do better in this church to make this church more effective? Because, you know, we can all only do so much and we all bring something to the table. And I've just got a few practical examples here I just want to go through and how if we're all involved in the work, you know, the work is easier to do and we're more effective when everyone in the church is doing it. And I'm just going to cover three areas and just go through what I've got listed here. Number one is soul winning. Right, soul winning is really important, right? That's why we are here on this earth. You know, we're not starting the purpose of this church. Yes, it's for fellowship, but we don't want it only to be about fellowship, right? Well, this church is a place where people can get encouraged and provoked and make friends, but so that we can go out and reach the lost, so that we can be a light in this neighborhood. And that's why we have the weekly soul winning and we try and get people along, we try and encourage people to go, because that is the work God has us to do. And you know, if we have more people going soul winning, we're going to have more people learning how to talk, right? And when we have more talkers, then we can bring along more silent partners. Even if you cannot talk, if more people go, if two people that can talk are going together, we can split them up, right? And we can cover more ground. So maybe in that day, you know, me and Michael went today Can't remember how many doors we knocked in the morning, maybe about 20, 15 to 20. But if we had two silent partners with us, you say, well, I'm going to go soul winning, I want to get involved, but I'm too scared to talk. And that's understandable. We don't expect people that are new to just, start talking straight away. But if two other silent partners had come with us, we might have knocked 30 doors in the same amount of time. And often people think, I can't do the talking. I'm not that great a talker. Well, you don't have to be that great a talker. You don't have to talk at all to reach double the amount of doors, right? Because there is a reason why we go two by two, because then one falls, the other can lift up his fellow. So it's not like me and Michael are just going to go, we're only human, we go soul winning a lot, but we're only human. We get discouraged. It's not easy soul winning. And that's why the more people that are involved, the more encouragement you get from others. Think about it. It's like when you create anything to do, you say, we're going to create this event, we're going to do this. If you're a sheep, if your mentality is not of a leader, like a leader will be there anyway, because a leader will go to be a leader and say, oh, I'm going to get involved because I want to set that example and I'm going to be there no matter what, right? But a sheep thinks, I wonder who else is going. Because if my mates aren't going, or nobody else is going, I don't go if nobody else is going. And it's like that with church. When there's a lot of people here, isn't it more exciting to be here when there's more people here? Have you been to church on those times when there's only a few seats? It's a little bit different just because it's encouraging. Presence is encouraging. Just being there is encouraging. It's encouraging to be good at it too. If you can excel and get better at soul winning, that's encouraging too. But just going is encouraging, right? Just being part of it, and you will be a partaker of that fruit. Think about it. If we had more people going, we would have more variation in personality, wouldn't we? And you guys know when you go soul winning, sometimes ladies connect better with ladies. More mature age people connect with more mature age people. Younger people connect with more younger people and things like that. We all have different backgrounds, different personalities. And the more of us that go soul winning, we will be able to try and reach those people too. Whereas you might go down a street and reach the people that another person may not otherwise reach. Or, if you're going in pairs, you still have that variability in personality as opposed to two people that are identical going together. And we even find that when we go soul winning. Like if I take my wife, people are more receptive, because when they see two guys, two dudes, it's very sometimes it's a bit more intimidating, isn't it? Whereas two ladies may get a chance to speak to a lady that two men otherwise she would shy away from. More encouragement from others, more unity, right? Because that's, you think in any church, there's always a core group in a church, right? And the reason why there's that core group in a church, because they're serving together. And people that never get involved in that core ministry of the church, they always feel on the outskirts, they know people, but they're not really really connected with each other. And it's because of that, because when you have a common goal, you're more involved in the ministries, you have more unity and more fellowship amongst your church members. So there's all these advantages. Think about this one. There's more times available to go, right? More people go, the more times you can offer for people to go. So if there's only one person going and they can only go, Wednesday and Sunday, then those are the only two times that somebody who's a silent partner will go. But if more people who are talkers go, and that's why, thank God, in our church, we are trying to do that, where, if more people are going soul winning, instead of just having official church soul winning times, we're just seeing, hey, when can you go? If you can go Sunday morning, then that's a group. There's enough people going, then they can go. And if they go Saturday afternoon and there's enough people going, then that's going to be a group that goes. So people won't have a reason not to go just because it's not a church, official soul winning time. I work on Saturday morning, so I can't go Saturday afternoon. I can't go Saturday morning. I have to go Saturday afternoon, but there's no time on Saturday afternoon. Well, if you go and somebody else goes, then we can make a time Saturday afternoon. We can make that a soul winning time. More people, and these are the obvious benefits. More people go, more people are going to get preached to and hear the gospel. More people are going to get saved, and there's going to be more glory to God. So that's soul winning. What about events? So, I mean, the principles kind of work the same way, because I suppose a soul winning is an event too, but that's for sort of encouraging people in the work. But just events like, you know, like yesterday, for example, you know, wasn't it nice that there were people there? You know, it's definitely encouraging for me. And I'm sure the people that went, it was fun as well. But even like, say, I mean, church, the church meeting is an event, right? Whether we have a social event or whatnot, or a church meeting, when more people are involved, what's some benefits? I mean, the work is lighter, isn't it? The work is lighter. Even the smallest task, I don't know, you can think of just some little task, maybe stacking the chairs, picking up a piece of rubbish. Even if you do the smallest task, you know what that means? Somebody else didn't need to have to do it. And when there's a church where everyone is involved and everybody is doing a little bit, many hands make light work. You know, and it's like when everyone gets involved to help set up and pack down, it just happens so quickly. But if not many people are helping, then it's a real stress and a strain on a few select people that are willing to do that work. So the work is lighter. We could have more events. You know, if we had more people involved, we could have more events, more variation of events, you know, rather than just the things that I organize. You know, we could have larger events, you know, because events can only get so large if only so many people are organizing them. We could have more complex events, right? We could have, you know, I guess when it comes to food and activities, if we had more people working, we could hold more things or have more things going on in a certain event. And I already sort of mentioned this, but, you know, it makes it more exciting to be there and encourages more people to go. And that's one of those things. You feel like you missed out when a lot of people went and you weren't there. Now, what's the last area? Last area is fellowship. You know, what, when everyone is involved in a church, how does that affect fellowship and the relationships? Well, number one, if you're doing your part in the relationship building of the church, then that means nobody will be forgotten about, right? Because we're proactive around, hey, you're making sure that people feel welcome, people feel connected, you know, people, you know, making friends. And if everyone's sort of doing their part and trying to make friends in church, it'll cover throughout the whole church and everybody will get to know each other. The church bonds will grow stronger. You know, that means less people getting out of church. Because oftentimes, even if you have good doctrine, you got good ministries, if you don't have friends there, generally people will go to a church where they have good friends or they know the people and there are people there that are praying for them. They care about them. They know what's happening in their life. And on the flip side of that coin, you know, it's not just what a church can do for you. And I always tell this to people that are looking for a church. You know, you don't want to just have the mentality of how can this church serve me, but what can I do to serve the church? How can I be a friend to somebody and think about others more? So no one will be forgotten about church bonds. And again, just like the soul winning, we'll reach a more variety of people, you know, age, gender, personal situations. Right? So we talked about age and gender, but even personal situations like life, you know, financial problems or financial situations, things like that. If we have more people knowing each other, you know, more people involved, you know, our church can cater and we can have these different social groups within our church and people can connect with one another. So this idea of teamwork, I mean, it's not foreign to the Bible. And obviously you guys would know that. But we'll go to 1 Corinthians 12 and we just wanted to read, this passage because the way the Word of God describes this, you know, this teamwork concept is it refers to the church as a body. And obviously we know that a body is a machine. It's a living machine, you know, that we all dwell in. And when it's all working well, it works better, doesn't it? We know that when we have a sore, you know, right now, I think I was running around a bit too much yesterday, running around. I actually like hurt my ankle a bit because my right foot's pretty bad in terms of I've got flat feet. And when I run too much barefooted, like it's my ankle and arch starts to get really sore. And then, you know, when my foot is sore, like I'm not as mobile anymore. It's doing okay now. But when I came home yesterday, I had to limp when I had to go to the shops this morning. I was limping through the shops with Simon. So we know that, you know, just like the human body, you know, when things are working and doing as they should, we know that the human body works well. And when something doesn't, what happens. It's very difficult, isn't it? So let's read through 1 Corinthians 12, and we'll just read through this, and I just got a few thoughts, and this is the passage I'll be ending on. And then I got a few other things I want to do, and then we'll take that photo. 1 Corinthians 12, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit." So a couple of thoughts I have here. The concept of teamwork. To more effectively achieve a common goal. Obviously, it's a biblical concept, right? It's going here, talking about here as, you know, we work together, we're one body, then that's going to be a lot more effective than us doing our own thing separately. But it's give and take, isn't it? Like even in the body, it, sometimes there's a time for that part to do its job, and sometimes there's a time for that body part to recover. You know, like, you know, you work your muscles and there's a time for that to rest, and then your other systems come into play to rejuvenate that. So it's the same in a church. If we think of ourselves as a body, you know, I'm not preaching this morning just so that you get this mentality that it's all give, because it's both, right? So it's not all take either, right? It's give and take. Because there are times when you're going to encourage somebody, your work is going to get people moving, your work is going to, you know, do something for the Lord, and the Lord is going to use you. But there are times when you need help, right? You need encouragement. You might be down. You may need an ear to listen to you. You may need a shoulder to cry on. You may need some help in your life. You know, we're all going through different struggles in life. You may need to approach other people to ask for help. Yeah, so, you know, it's give and take. And this is something that as Christians, we have to learn. You know, it's the same with advice. You need to learn to be able to give advice, but you also need to learn to take advice. But also with support in other areas of life, like finances. You know, in a country like ours where we're very prosperous, people become very proud, right? Because they're not in a country where people normally are used to receiving. And when you need help, and somebody tries to help you, what's your first reaction? Oh, no, it's okay. So it's okay to receive. There is a time to give, there's a time to receive. And I think in our country, sometimes people are not very good at receiving. Somebody might want to give you a gift. Somebody might want to help you with something. But if you are always closed-fisted, you got to think about it not selfishly. Yes, you may not realize you need the help, but you're also robbing that person of a blessing too. Like they might want to be a blessing to you, and that might just be a time for you to receive. You know, we talk about, you know, people pray all the time that God would help them, and then somebody in church wants to help them. What do they do? No, help me. How do you think God is trying to help you? He's using his servants to help you. You need to be ready to receive when God helps you, and ready to give when you have the means to. That's why I don't turn away gifts. You know, I'm not, if somebody gives me something, then I just appreciate it and accept it. And there'll be a time where I give something and I help somebody, and it's just give and take in a body. We see here that, you know, it says here, we're one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles. So you see here, it's internationality. Whether we are bond or free, you know, and that could refer to maybe our employment status, right? Well, or how we work. Some people may be financially dependent. Some people might be financially independent. But you see here, those walls all break down in a church. And that's why churches should not be oriented towards one nationality. It doesn't even make sense, right? We're all one in Christ Jesus. You know, why would you have a church that only reaches, you know, Chinese people? I mean, unless it's like obviously for language reasons, because language, you know, you can't even understand what everyone's talking about. You're not going to have unity there. But if it's just your nationality, but you all speak the same language, there's no reason why a church should only target one nationality, because, you know, as a church of Jesus Christ, we should be able to put our cultural prejudices aside, right? And be able to reach out and have this common bond and common blood between here. That's why I love our church. Our church is so multinational. And it's great. And you don't even notice it. Do you know what I mean? Like people think, like, oh yeah, our church is so multicultural. Whereas, you know, when I talk to Kev or I talk to Michael, there's no difference to me. It's just got a different accent. That's all. But we're all Christians. We all love the Lord and we all want to be part of this body. All right, let's go on. So, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? So, you know, you think, oh, that's not my church, but I'm here. Well, that doesn't make you not part of the church. You're part of the church, you know, because you're here. And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? All right, so I've got some thoughts on those four verses. So we're not all the same, but everyone plays their part, right? And it's part of the body, just like it says here. You know, some people are an eye, some people are an ear, and we all do our part. And if something is missing, somebody's not doing their part, something's missing, isn't it? So it's not that I can just be part of this church, sort of cruise under the radar, and I have a neutral effect, right? I'm not adding or subtracting. That's not true. Because you're part of this body. If you're not doing what you should do, the body's not doing something it could do, right? And I like to think of it like when we talk about the church being like a ground and a garden. If there is a tree in a garden that is not does not have any fruit, that's not a neutral tree, is it? Because that tree requires resources. You know, it takes up shade, it takes up space, it takes up things like that. And if it's not bearing fruit, then it's not as an effective of a tree as it could be. And it's the same in the body. So Jesus said, you know, you're either gathering or you're scattering. And that's true, right? If you are not in the direction of gathering, then you're scattering. So we need to think about our effect on the body of Christ. And just on this point, it's actually funny because I hope you don't mind me sharing this, Anthony. But it's funny because yesterday, Anthony came to the Rainy anniversary, and it's anniversary. I'm not having a go at him, but he didn't survive. He didn't survive it because he's got a young baby and things like that. So it's understandable, right? I mean, I think Elizabeth would probably feel the same way if Abel was much, much younger. So Christine and Gershon, it's easy because they only have one kid, right? So they can just protect Atticus. But what was funny was he was putting up this gazebo, right? He brought this gazebo and he was putting it up, but he didn't have pegs, right? But then I had brought pegs for my tent, but I don't think my tent would have withstood the wind. So then I brought the pegs that Anthony needed to put up his gazebo. And even though Anthony didn't last the whole day, he ended up leaving, he left his gazebo and table there for us to use. And if it wasn't for his gazebo, we wouldn't have been able to get our barbecue started, right? Because we weren't able to have the barbecues underneath the undercover areas, that you have to have it on the grass. So because we could have that barbecue up and running, that was the barbecue that cooked everybody's food and fed everybody. So if you think about it, right, if Anthony had not decided to at least come and bring that gazebo, we would be in even more of a world of it yesterday because we would have to go and buy food or, you know, everyone would have bailed, I don't know. So I just think that was funny. I was just using that as an analogy as, you know, everyone puts in their part, you know, that's what made it work. We came together and we made it work. And even though Anthony wasn't able to stay for the whole time, he played a major part in making that day a success. So you got to remember, if someone doesn't do their part, something will be missing from church. You know, I don't always know what it is, but something is not as well as it could be. You know, we can change from one body part to another sometimes. So we're not always one body part and always stay that body part in a body. But we see here, you know, an issue of the lack of ownership. In the sense, so he says, if I'm not the ear, I'm not of the body. If I'm not the eye, I'm not of the body. It's kind of like, well, I'm not this in church, and therefore it's like I'm not really part of it. That's like what they do. You know, I don't want people to have this mentality that this is Victor's church. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm helping Victor's church. No, you know, it's your church as well. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's, you know, the church is more than preaching. I know churches, that's what they're known for, right? Because that's what gets put on the internet and that's what's publicized. But those of you who are in this church, you know there is more to this church than just the teaching. Right? Because there are the relationships, there are the people you know, there are the friendships, there are the activities. Because I'm not just like this octopus that just like is with everybody, right? Like, I can only talk to so many people on Sunday. So even if you think about the Sunday night, there is more to dinner than just me, isn't there? And sometimes people listen, you know, they listen online to the sermons and they think that because that all they're hearing is the sermons, that's all they think church is about. Right, so I might not preach on certain topics, I might not talk about certain topics because it actually takes quite a bit of work to prepare to teach something, right? And sometimes when you don't have enough time, you don't want to just preach sort of something half-baked. So you sort of preach things that you know a bit more about. But that's not all we talk about, because some people might think, well, is that, you know, this church is not hitting on that because they're not preaching on that. But then as a church, we talk about these things. So you see how there's more to church than just the preaching, right? There's more to church than just what I do. So you need to have this idea that this is not my church. Yes, I'm trying to get this going, and there's a few of us trying to get this going because we want to be used by the Lord to build this church, but it will never be just me. It'll never be just me or just a few people, because we are a body. And what's interesting here, where it says here, if the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? So sometimes I think as well, like when I read this, it's almost like there are different tasks that need to be done. But if all the resources going, if you think about it in a body, right? If all the resources of a body go into hearing, it's like, where were the smelling? Or if it's like, if all goes into smelling and hearing, where's the speaking? And you've got to think about this as well at church. When one thing doesn't get done, remember I talked about, somebody else has to do it. And sometimes it's like that. It's like yesterday, right? Yesterday, I really wanted, I mean, it rained as well. But I really wanted yesterday to be a day where we could do some things, have a program, right? Have games for the kids, have some preaching. But because I had to like organize everything, I felt like it was a bit too stressful. So I just like said, hey, I'm just going to have a day where we can sort of relax. So sometimes I think it's like that. It's like if you have an event, like we talked about having bigger events, if more people are involved and can take care of those tasks, then we can have more preaching and things like that. Because say we have a few preachers in this church, you know, we have me, Kevin, and maybe others that might step up to the plate. But if we're the same people organizing the event, right? Let's say we put on an event, right? And you need obviously logistics and catering and organizing people, you know, messaging people, communication. There's all these things that go on. And if the people that have to prepare the sermons to feed you are also the people that have to organize everything, it's a bit like this. It's like, if the all were organizing, where were the preaching? Do you know what I mean? Or likewise, if it's all preaching, then the organization is going to think. So that's why it's so important that even if you're not in the limelight as such, that what you do does make a difference, even if it's small. So there we go. Let's go on. 18. So, but now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, yet but one body. So it's interesting here that God sets the members in the church. Why? Because he builds the church. You know, Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So you know what brought you here? It's interesting, eh? If God builds the church, you might think, well, I'm here because of this person. But then it's actually God that reached out to you, and that's why you're here. He's got a purpose for you in this church. He's got a purpose for you and what he wants you to do. He has works for you that he has before ordained that you should walk in them, and he has led you to this place. Because this is how God builds the church. I'll show you this interesting passage in 1 Samuel 10. You know, after Samuel anointed Saul as king, and Samuel said to all the people, "See ye him whom the Lord hath chosen, that there is none like him among all the people." And all the people shouted and said, "God save the king." Then Samuel told the people the manner of the kingdom and wrote it in a book and laid it up before the Lord. And Samuel sent all the people away, every man to his house. And Saul also went home to Gibeah, and there went with him a band of men whose hearts God had touched. So even no matter how great the leader is, it's interesting that these people end up following him, not because of how great Saul was, not even because of like, you know, how great the church was, but it's because God touched their heart somehow and prepared for that work for them to do. And let me just read this last bit. So let's go back here. "And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more than those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honourable, upon these we bestow more abundant honour, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honour to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it, or one member be honoured, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular, and God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? So you see, even in the Corinthian church, there's all these different things that were happening. All these different gifts. But he says here, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. And that's always interesting that the way 1 Corinthians 12 ends, because it talks about all these different gifts and all these different talents and all these different roles in the church. And he's saying, hey, you know, yeah, you want to desire spiritual gifts, but let me show you an even better way. And then that is the segue into 1 Corinthians 13. And if you're familiar with 1 Corinthians 13, that is the chapter on charity and love. So isn't that interesting that he wants us to desire talent and spiritual gifts, but even more so, the more excellent way is simply to love one another and have fervent charity amongst yourselves. And why is that? Because, you know, Jesus said, you know, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if you have love one for another. And it's interesting, he didn't say he'll know that you're saved because you have love one for another, because you can be saved and not have love one for another. But he says, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples. Because we know whether you're following Jesus or not is because whether you love the brethren. But we see here as well, you know, when it talks about, I have no need of you and all that sort of thing, where it sort of touches on, you know, church members despising one another or thinking that somebody is useless in a church or it doesn't contribute anything. Remember I talked about just being there, you contribute. You know, just saying hello to somebody, you contribute. So everybody contributes, you know. Yes, do some people contribute more than others? Of course, because we all have different talents and abilities. We're all walking in the Spirit, sometimes more than others. And likewise, there's that shift. We all have strengths and weaknesses. We don't want to make excuses for our weaknesses, but let's not also get prideful if we don't struggle in the same areas that others may, right? There's always a reason why someone is in a church, even if you think they have no purpose, right? Because they're part of the body. It says here, it talks about our uncomely parts, the ones that, you know, maybe are not so beautiful, not so seen, yet they can often play a crucial role. And what if it's just somebody to relate to somebody else? What if they've gone through a struggle and the reason why they're in that church, because somebody else will go through that same struggle and will be able to provide some comfort or at least some fellowship, some empathy, understanding, hey, I went through that same thing. There's no vestigial organs, right? Just like, you know, the evolutionists always teach, oh, this vestigial organ, that vestigial organ is useless, and then they start finding out that there's actually a use for them. It's the same in a body. There's no vestigial organ, useless church member. There's no vestigial church member. Let's see the value of each other as God sees it. But at the same time, we want to provoke each other unto love and good works. So I've got here, we should all rejoice at growing in the faith, no matter how fast or slow, as long as we are moving in the right direction. So I touched on the more excellent way being love, you know, if you have love one for another. And it's to show that you're a disciple. I think that's an interesting point that, you know, if you love your brothers and sisters in the Lord, then that shows the world that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. Did he say, you know, by your doctrine you'll know that you're my disciples? The world will know that you're my disciples? He didn't say, you know, by your fancy building. He didn't say, you know, by, you know, your talents and programs, you know, by, you know, how much money you have, they'll know that you're my disciples. It wasn't the doctrine. It's interesting, eh? When Jesus said, how are men going to know that you're my disciples? Because this is how you love one another. They see how much a church loves one another and cares for one another. And he says, hey, this is the way the world knows. Hey, these are followers, disciples of Jesus Christ. Now let's go to Colossians. Colossians 4:6. And I won't read all of this for the sake of time, but I just wanted to show you here that there are other places where Paul has recognized people. And it's what's interesting in the Colossian letter, after he mentions these different people and the things that they've done, you know, we got here Luke, the beloved physician, Demas greet you. So we know Demas didn't have a good end, but Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke. He says, salute the brethren which are in Laodicea, Nymphos, and the church which is in his house, And when this epistle is read among you, cause that it be read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that ye likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. And this is the point I want to work on, I want to finish on. So we see here that Paul is giving us these names not only to show how many people are involved, and obviously there are people that aren't mentioned that are involved as well. You know, he's not mentioning everybody there, but he's noting a few people to honor them, right? And not only that, it wasn't like this secret letter. I mean, we know it ended up in the Bible, but even we read here in the epistle to the Colossians, when he wrote the letter to the Colossians, he says, hey, I want you to read this letter not only in the church in Colossae, but also in Laodicea. And there's a letter I've written in Laodicea, which I want you to read at Colossae. So these people that he is recognizing and honoring, this is a public recognition, isn't it? This is like them honoring the people that are doing and doing the most work and honoring them and giving them some honor amongst the church. And that's one thing I want to do today. You know, I want to honor some people today. I've got some things for you guys. And I want to show you this verse lastly in Proverbs. Proverbs 27:2. Before I do this, I want to show you just this principle where praise is good. It's biblical to praise one another, you know, as opposed to speaking your own praises, right? I mean, sometimes we have to sell our value when we go for a job interview. But when it talks about, you know, just us being so great, you know, you say, oh, I'm so great or whatever, you know, that's not for us to do. But it says here in Proverbs 27:2, let another man praise thee and not thine own mouth, a stranger and not thine own lips. So I think it's very biblical that churches do this, that churches do recognize people that are carrying a lot of the weight and helping out and honoring them within the church. So I'd like to do that. And I've got a few things. I went to the shops this morning to pick up a few things. And I just wanted to honor a couple of people this morning. And what should I do first? All right. The first person I would like to just recognize, and I hope you don't get this sort of mindset. You know, if you didn't get something today, that, you know, obviously, we all put in something. You can't. We don't live in the snowflake generation where everybody gets a gold star, right? Like, not everyone's mentioned in the Bible. So I'm sort of just noting the people that have helped make my life really easy and have been consistent in their service and are helping me out and were willing to take on some responsibility when I asked it of them. So the first person I want to recognize is Nathan. So Nathan, if you want to come up, thank you. So Nathan, what have I got for you? I've only got two different types of gifts here, but I wrote your name on both things. Nathan. So Nathan has been a real blessing to me, just because, you know, he's been... Thanks, man. Yeah, so it's something. And obviously the value of the gift is not reflective of the value you bring to this church, but this is a toothpaste, some non-fluoride toothpaste, and also just a token to get yourself something. But Nathan's been really great because you guys know he's been new to church, but he jumped straight in. You know, he's helping us set up and pack down. But not only that, Nathan helps to captain one of the soul winning teams. So he has his own sort of section on the map that he really helps. You know, that's a really big help because it's quite stressful when there are big groups and everyone's coming for soul winning to be able to organize our people. But I can count on Nathan to, you know, I throw him like three people and he takes charge and he tells them where they need to go and what they need to do. And I very rarely need to look after that. So I really thank Nathan for that. All right, the next person I want to recognize and honor is Alex. So Alex, I mean, Alex and I talk a lot. He's been a real good help to me. Just because, you know, he's the one that actually goes and picks up the food every week. And I just wait there to get you something. What have I got for you? I think I got you the same thing. All right, so there you go, it's for you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, James. All good.
Right, thank you. So, I mean, me and Alex talk all the time. We're really good friends as well. And, you know, he knows where he needs to improve and things like that. But he's been a really good help. You know, even though we've all got areas we can improve in, but Alex is generally, he's always, more often than not, been somebody that stays behind late. You know, he's at the end taking out the bins. Alex actually, you know, helps us look after all the fellowship stuff. So he's responsible for setting up the tables and taking out the bins and things like that. And not only that, but every week he's happily goes and picks up our food from El Jana so that we have something to eat. All right, the next person I would like to on is Kevin. Kevin, if you want to come up. What have I got for you? I think I got you that too. I happen to do all the toothpaste people first. Thanks, Kevin. Thanks so much for everything you do.
Thank you.
And there you go. Get yourself a little something. So I don't need to say much about Kevin. You guys know he's not only a counselor to me, but also he carries a lot of the weight of preaching to you guys and feeding you guys. And for those of you who don't preach, it's a lot of work to put a sermon together. And all of us are busy these days, right? I mean, you think of Kevin, he's got 9 kids to look after, yet he helps me to take care of stocking up the toilet. You know, when you go to the toilet and there's toilet paper there and there's paper towel in the kitchen, that's because Kevin's making sure that is all stocked up. And not only that, he helps me preach every couple of weeks so that I have more time to prepare sermons as well. So it's going to be a real shame, you know, when Kevin goes to the Sunshine Coast, but just like with starting any church, you know, it's a bittersweet moment, isn't it? You know, when you have to send people away, but you know they're going to do a great thing for the Lord. All right, next person. It's going to be Christina Solomon. If you want to come up? Got something for you. Now, you guys get a little something different because I know you guys have already tried the toothpaste, so this one is some organic coconut butter.
Oh, wow, thank you.
Yeah.
Oh,
thanks so much for everything you do.
Thank you.
So Christina is responsible for the kitchen, if you didn't know that. So Christina looks after all the supplies. She lets me know when things are running low and does a great job at that. You know, whenever I go in, I rarely have to, you know, finish anything off, and it's such a blessing to be able to just know you can lock the kitchen and everything's clean and wiped down and put away. So thank you so much, Christina, for looking after that, and everyone for being so willing to look after. I've got one more jar of coconut butter. And I really want to honor Michael today. So I left Michael till last because, you know, it goes without saying, you know, Michael's actually started this church with me. And, you know, he's a blessing in so many different areas. I'm sure if I was to survey the church and ask, you know, who's the most effective, who does the most work, I'm sure Michael would be high up there and get a tick. So thanks, Michael. I got you a little something.
Jesus.
And some coconut butter. And Michael is great because we know that Michael doesn't do things, you know, for praise. He's a very sort of secretive guy. And that's why I think it's a great thing to be able to honor these people and lift them up in the eyes of the church and the eyes of God, because they really do make things so much easier. I mean, if I was to list off the things Michael helps me with, it would take a while. But he does so much here. He's usually the first to get here. He's the last to leave. And not only that, like, Michael helps me a lot in personal issues as well. I mean, he's done things around the house for me and stuff like that. And I'm sure he's done a lot for other people in this church as well. He's a real blessing. So I just want to give a round of applause to these 5 people. Thank you so much, guys, for your work. And like I said, I know there are a lot of other, you know, our church is very small. There's a lot of you that do put in a lot of work, and it's not that it's not valued, but the reason why I've just honored these people today, like I said, is because I've actually asked them to take on some responsibilities, and they were willing and glad to do it, and it's been a great help making this church run so much smoother. Okay, so that's all I have. I know I'm running a bit over time, but let's sing one more song. A Wonderful Savior. And then,
just before we sing that song,
what happened?
A special announcement. I guess if Victor can come up, also if he can invite his family as well. Interesting how he ended with praise there. And this is more just an announcement of thanks, really. Thanks from God, for God, just for your service and your help and your family as well. So just the hard work you put in the last 2 years. And I guess just before I give you the little gift, this is coming from me, like, the last, just to butter you up a bit. I've been in the Independent Baptist movement for a long time, like, just seeing the church and, like, just knowing what what they taught, how they ran things. And like only the year prior before this church started, like sort of my scale, like scales of my eyes came off. I was like, yeah, wow, we need a church like, you know, sort of like Faithful Word. I was like, we're looking for it in Sydney. And just hearing like Victor was gonna start one is like starting to get exciting. So just seeing all that. And then once it started, it was like, wow, like I can't believe it's here. Like the best church in the world, like just 1 hour, less than an hour away from my house. Like what a privilege and what a blessing. And just thanks to God once again, just the 2 years. And just seeing how Victor is as a friend, and just some of the things personally that he's helped me with. And just not only like, cause some of the pastors I've seen, and especially in the Baptist movement, like, you know, sometimes they feel like they're in an ivory tower, like hard to talk to, hard to see that they're human. But with Victor, like whenever I talked with him, he felt like, you know, I could talk to him in a human level. Like he sees the flaws, he knows how to deal with it. You know, we're all human, we've all got the flesh that we deal with. And just from that point, I was like, wow, like not only something with good doctrine, but like just how we struggle with it. We like to see all Paul's struggles with his life as well in Romans and Corinthians. Like it's just the same thing from Victor's life, like just seeing how he puts through things and just helping me. So just from me, but like this last two, three months leading up to today, like the rest of us got together and just put some things together. One, just a monetary gift.
So thanks, man. Thanks a lot.
From everyone.
Thank you.
And just a handshake. So thank you, guys.
Thanks, Gareth. Thanks for your kind words. Thank you. Thanks, guys. It's funny that, like, I didn't know, like, whether you guys were organizing something, but I was like, because last year you sort of surprised me, and I was thinking, are you guys going to try and do it again? That's why I was trying to surprise you. I was like, you know what? You honored me last year. This time I'm going to honor you. And then you spring it on me again. But thank you so much. Yeah, this is the greatest church. You know, I think we've got something really special here, in the sense that, you know, like I make it a point, and that's part of the reason why I dress this way. I try and make it a point because I want to be like on the same level as you guys, in the sense that, you know I have to sometimes make hard decisions, or sometimes I have to make decisions that not everyone agrees with, or I have to be the one to make the decisions. But at the same time, like Gershon was saying, like, I'm just one of you. You know, I have the same struggles. You know, I go through the same things. And that's great. Thank you so much, Gershon. And thank you, church. Okay. All right, I forgot there. Let's sing a song. I thought it would be a great song to end on. A Wonderful Savior. And then we'll head on outside, and then we'll take a photo, and then Alex can go with some people to pick up the food. All right, here we go. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up, and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers covers me there with his hand. When clothed his brightness transported, I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. All right, let's pray. All right, thank you, Lord, for this meeting. Thank you for 2 great years. Thank you, Lord, for our church, and pray that we'll continue to grow in friendship, Lord, grow in grace, grow in our work. And thank you so much, Lord, that we have this church today. I'm sure so many people around the world, around Australia, would love to be in a church like this. And thank you, Lord, that we have it. So we pray, Lord, that we would be grateful for what we have. Lord, we'd make the most of it. And Lord, I pray that we'd continue to move onward and upward. Help us, Lord. We need your grace. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Great. All right. Hope you guys enjoy. All right. Let's head outside and I'll try and set up this camera. Take a photo. Hopefully it's not raining.